Hi everyone, it's Sam from Sitemate. In this video, we're going to look at how you can use Dashpivot for timesheets. And timesheets are used to track labor hours of your workforce. They're typically submitted by workers for review and approval before being processed by your finance department. Dashpivot makes it really easy to create those timesheets and process them using formulas and workflows to sort of automate different aspects of that process. So when you first open up Dashpivot, you'll want to go to the template section. And if you don't have a timesheet template already set up in your account, you'll want to click the Add Template button and follow the prompts. You can either create a new timesheet template completely from scratch, or you can use a free template that we have available in our free public template library. Just search for timesheet and add that into your account. You can always make changes later. And once you've got the timesheet template added, we'll need to go and start filling it out. So you can see we've got our timesheet template here. This one is set up as a workflow. And what's neat about this workflow is that if we add a new timesheet, all of the forms, when they're initially created, will all sit in the very first column. And it's only once they're signed off that they actually move from one column to the next. So if you can imagine an employee goes in, creates their timesheet, and it sits in the first column, they fill out all the details, they click sign, it then moves to this second column, and we can actually make it automatically notify someone. So in this case, it might be our supervisor. We automatically notify the supervisor. They then come into Dashpivot, they open up that timesheet, they review the contents, and they can sign it off and then move it to the closed column. And so if you've got a lot of people in your team, it makes it really easy to see what stage each timesheet is up to, who created it, what changes have been made to it, and so on and so forth. So let's run through an example. Let's create a new timesheet by clicking this green button. So here we have our timesheet, and you can see it's comprised of several fields. This is all customizable, which we'll get to in just a minute, but we can start to fill it out. So we can put in the week of this timesheet. We can put in the name of the person who this timesheet is for. We can select our trade type, etc. And then what's obviously unique to the timesheet is that we have a table where we're recording our start and finish times throughout the week. And in Dashpivot, we can actually automate the calculation of the hours based on the start and finish time. And this table here even utilizes a formula to auto-calculate overtime, and it will give us a sum at the bottom. So to show you what I mean, let's just populate a couple of these. So if we put in 7 a.m. until, let's say, 4:30. So it auto-calculates the hours, but we need to account for a break. So if we put in 0.5, which would be half an hour, you can see it's then adjusted to exclude those break hours. And you see that we have 8 hours of work, of regular work, and then we've got an hour of overtime. And it's going to do this for every row. So if we start at 7 again tomorrow, and then we finish up at, let's say, 5 o'clock, and then again, we have half hour of break. You can see that it's auto-calculated the hours worked and the overtime. And down the bottom of all of these rows, we can see that we're getting the total hours worked. So we have 16 hours so far and 2.5 hours of overtime. We're not going to go through the whole table. I think you get the idea. You just work your way through, fill it out, and it does the auto-calculations for you. Now, I just want to show you, before we continue, I just want to show you that if we save the form, you'll see that it's been generated inside of Dashpivot, so we can come back to it, we can make changes. But in order to move it from this first column through to the supervisor review column, we'll need to sign it off. But what we want to do at the same time is actually notify, in this case, the supervisor, when this form moves into this column. So to do that, we need to enable some notifications, and we can do that by selecting this eyeball icon at the top of the workflow column. So we select that button, and then we can choose from the people who have access to this particular team folder who we'd like to notify. So in this case, maybe Anne is our supervisor. So let's select Anne's name. And this just means that every time a form moves into this column, Anne's going to get an email notification. So to do that, we open up our form again. We'll scroll down. You can see that we've got our first what's called approval signature. This is what's going to move the form from one column to the next. There is another one because we have three columns in our workflow. So we'd need to sign off that second one in order to move it to the last column. But you can see it's disabled. That's because we haven't signed off the first one just yet. So let's do that now. Let's sign it. And a couple things happen when we sign it. It actually locks all of the fields above our signature. So this table can't be adjusted anymore. It's put our signature on there with the time and date and our name. And then below that, we now have our next approval signature, which could be signed. But we're not going to do that just yet. Presumably that would be for Anne in this example. So we're just going to save this form. And you can see it's now moved across into the middle column. And because we've set Anne to receive a notification, we can be sure that Anne will have received an email with a link that says, hey Anne, there's a timesheet in the supervisor review column in this project, in this team folder. Click here to view it. And if she clicks the link and opens up Dashpivot, she can then review the content, sign it, and move it through to the closed column once it's been reviewed. So it's very straightforward. What I'd like to show you now is how you can edit this timesheet template if you wanted to have some different drop-down values or you wanted to add some other detail or take some detail out. You can always edit the templates inside of Dashpivot. This particular template was actually set up in the home folder. So we'll need to click on the home folder and go to the template library. And again, we just need to find our timesheet template. Here it is. We need to select it and then click the edit template button. And there's all sorts of things that you can change in here. If you haven't seen this before, it's just a series of fields that you can choose from and you can sort of drag and drop them sort of into the template itself. So you just sort of click and drag. You can rearrange them and so on and duplicate them and all sorts of things. They all have sub options. But you can make some adjustments to this template and what's included in it, including the values of the drop-down lists or the formulas that you have or the days in the or the rows in the table which represent the days. There's heaps of things that you can change in here. And as soon as you make any changes, as soon as you save those, it'll distribute across anyone who's using this template. So the next time that an employee goes to fill out a timesheet, it'll use the most up-to-date version straight away. All you have to do is make those changes and click save and it's done. So it's very easy to amend. One thing that does come up quite a bit with timesheets is wanting to have a drop-down list of personnel or employees or a drop-down for different cost codes inside of your table. So if you're working on a big job and you want to be able to allocate those hours to specific cost codes, you might want to implement a list drop-down in a certain column. We don't have one here, but it would be very easy to just add in an extra column and change these inputs to be a drop-down list. And then you can actually link that to a list that exists in the background. In this case, we already have one ready to go called cost codes. And that would mean that every time we fill out this row, we've now got the option to fill out the cost code cell. And that's handy later on when we get to analytics, which we'll just get to in just a moment. But I just want to show you where lists are managed. So you can see this personnel list is linked to this template. If we just exit out of the template builder, the list section is where all of your lists are managed. So if we go to lists, you can see that we've already got a list for personnel. We've already got a list for cost codes. So these sort of sit in the background and then can be referenced by multiple different templates. You might be using your list of people or personnel for your timesheet, for your daily diary, for your checklists, for your inspections, all sorts of things. So it's nice to have a single point of truth for that list of people. So it's one place where you have to update it. And that would be managed via the list section. Now, over time, you're going to end up with something that looks like this in your timesheet workflow as your team starts to fill it out, both on the website and in the mobile app. The mobile app is really handy because it's got offline mode, it's got autosave, it's got stacks of other features like photo markup, photo stamping, GPS and date stamping, among other things. But it's very easy to fill out timesheets and other forms using the mobile app. And as we've seen in this video, it's very easy to fill them out on the website as well. If you need to go back and find a specific timesheet, we have this thing called Register View. If we click on the register, it actually converts all the information contained into those forms into something that's more like a spreadsheet. So we have a row for every one of those forms that has been filled out so far, and we have columns for each of the fields. And what's really handy is we can filter by those columns. So if we wanted to look for a timesheet from a particular person, we could filter for, let's just say, for Ben, apply that filter, and then it returns only the timesheets where Ben's name was selected. We can apply multiple filters as well. Obviously, if you've got hundreds and hundreds of timesheets, this feature becomes really handy. And then once you've found what you're looking for, you can always do a bulk export. So you can select either the forms individually or just bulk select everything that's displayed on the page. We've got a CSV export if you want to import that into something like Excel. And then we've also got a PDF export options as well. So feel free to explore those. The last thing I want to cover in this video is the analytics. So assuming that we've been using our timesheets for some time and we've been logging in all of these hours, we can actually use the analytics section to plot those hours over time. So let's head to the analytics section. We already have a dashboard set up with a couple of charts. It's this dashboard here called Labor. So if we go into that Labor dashboard, we have a couple of charts, but just want to draw your attention to this one, which is actually tracking just the total hours per person over time. So the different colors in this case represent the different people. And if we hover on any of these weeks, we can see how many hours each person had worked. And this is showing us the cumulative number over time. So you can see it's slowly growing. There's a couple of things down here, like you can change the settings, the time frame, what value you want to break it down by, whether you want to display it as an area chart or, you know, a line chart. There's a couple of different options. You can also apply filters in the same way that you could apply filters in the register view. So if you want to look for the hours of a particular person, it would be very easy to do that. And one last note about timesheets. In cases where you don't want employees to be able to see each other's timesheets, we recommend setting up a project folder just called Employees and setting up a team folder for each person. Just call each folder the person's name and then invite that person to that folder along with anyone else who needs to review the timesheet. And then what it means is that each person will have their own dedicated team folder to then go ahead and fill out timesheets and won't be able to see each other's. So if we were Bob and we logged in as Bob, and Bob is only going to see this team folder. He wouldn't see John Smith or Sam Taylor. He'd only see his own name under the folder. So that would be the place for him to then go and fill out his timesheet. So it makes it really easy to know where to go and keeps everyone's timesheets somewhat separate. So they're all stored in different folders. And so if you do this, if you want to set up your folders this way, just make sure that you set up your timesheet template within your home folder's company template library. So that way you'll still get a master register of all of your timesheets in your home folder, even though technically they're being filled out within each team folder. So it's kind of like you fill it out in the team and then at the home folder you can see all of them. But this hinges on making sure that you set up your timesheet template within your home folder. So be sure to do that. And that's how you can use Dashpivot for timesheets. We have stacks of other videos available in the tutorial section covering off things like formulas, workflows, analytics, and the setting up of folders inside your organization. So be sure to check those out. But if you get stuck with anything, you can always send our team a message just via the live chat on the website or via the mobile app. So that's all for this video, and thanks for watching.